All right. Good afternoon. I am so excited to have everyone here. This is our first edition of Cocktails and Conservation with the National Wild Turkey Federation. We're going to have a little fun today, and no doubt we may even have a drink. I know I am, because we have some deep things to talk about. This is all a part of our spring seclusion series. This is going to be the first of six episodes that we're going to do. Every Wednesday, 5 p.m., as they say, it's 5 o'clock somewhere. Well, it is 5 o'clock here, folks, and we're gonna have a little fun with this. We're gonna ask some questions and get some information from the experts today. So let me do a little introduction of who we are. I'm Jason Lapardus. I work with the National Wild Turkey Federation, aka as a wildlife biologist forester. I guess I have this crazy title as a director of our conservation operations here in the Midwestern states. Based out of the great bluegrass state of Kentucky, and we have a little bit of fun sipping bourbon today in true Kentucky fashion. And but we're going to turn this over here in a bit to our compadres, our experts, so to speak, to have a little discussion. And our two experts that you're going to see week after week for the next 6 weeks is Dr. Bret Collier and Dr. Michael Chamberlain. These guys are just true professionals in the turkey arena. They have a credibility beyond the days that most of us can talk good turkey stories. And we're going to use their knowledge and what they've compiled in the science arena to help guide us on a lot of things we have questions about. Maybe we're going to solve a few wives' tales today and figure some things out that we didn't know as much about. So that's all very good. Today's focus is going to be all about predators. And I know we have a ton of questions. Even I have questions. So I hope everyone's ready. We're going to kick this off for about 30 minutes of just some discussion we're going to have to kind of tee everything off, get folks kind of in tune to what we're talking about, give y'all the basic framework of predators and how all that kind of relates to turkeys, et cetera. And then we'll move into some questions because we want folks out there, send us questions, give us some comments. This is going to be a family flock discussion, folks. So please engage. We're glad to have you. Thanks for being here. Thanks for showing up. I'm going to turn this over. Let's start with Dr. Mike Chamberlain for a minute and give us a little bit about your background before we got to kick this thing off.
Yeah, Jason. So I grew up in Virginia, suburban kid. Grew up as a hunter, fisherman. Went to Virginia Tech, did an undergraduate degree there, and then went to Mississippi State for both my master's and my PhD. Left Starkville and ended up in Baton Rouge, where I taught at LSU for about 11 years, and then came to UGA about nine and a half years. So I've been studying turkeys pretty much since 1993. So I guess I'm in my 27th year at this point. It makes me sound really old. Yeah.
Hey man, that's good. Man, glad to have you on. I know we're gonna have some good candid discussion today. You've been releasing some great information on Turkey Tuesday, and so we appreciate that. Thanks for allowing us to kind of share your information and stimulate a lot of good discussion. Brett, let's turn this over to you, man. I want to hear a little bit about your background as I'm sipping my old fashioned here.
Sure, as I'm sipping water tonight. Just keep straight and narrow on that. So I'm Bret Collier. I'm a professor at Louisiana State University. I guess my route was I grew up in East Central Illinois, kind of small town country guy, I guess. My friends will laugh at me for saying that. Then I headed down to Oklahoma State for a master's and University of Arkansas for a PhD. And then I went to Texas A&M for about 10 years, where I spent most of my time working on RIOs with Texas Parks and Wildlife. And then in 2014, I was hired at Louisiana State University, and I've been working with Louisiana Department of Wildlife Fisheries studying wild turkey ecology for them as well. I guess, I mean, Mike and I are about the same age. He just got a little bit of a head start on me. So I guess I'm in about my 17th or so year studying the wild turkey in the United States. So,
That's awesome, guys. Well, definitely appreciate y'all being on here. We have a ton of turkey knowledge, no doubt. Between a little bit of my ramblings and the expert knowledge here, we'll figure a few things out today. Maybe have a little fun while we're doing it. So we're gonna kind of kick into what I call the framework of what we're going to talk about, predators, et cetera, just so that folks understand a little bit more about the basic biology of the bird and how that impacts how they function each day. So let's look at how birds evade predators. I think that's very important knowledge to understand to kind of frame this out. I mean, birds have this excellent vision, et cetera, but just kind of curious, I mean, what is their strongest defense? Is it their vision? Is it their hearing? I mean, you tell me. I'm kind of curious myself. What do you think, guys?
Well, yeah. So turkeys have what's called monocular periscopic vision, and all that means is they don't see dimensions like we do. They turn their head, and basically, when they do that, it allows them essentially a 360 degree view of their surroundings. So they don't see the type of detail that we see, but they see all around them, which is very common in species that are eaten by other stuff. So, you know, if things eat you, then you need to be able to see. So basically that's turkey vision. And unlike us, their eyes are dominated, the retinas are dominated by cones. So they don't see at night well. They have excellent vision during the day, as any turkey hunter can attest to. But at night, they really struggle because they have a lack of rods that gives them the ability to see in the dark.
So holy moly, man, you're telling me, which, you know, I know a little bit about this as well, but for the average person out there, you're telling me that turkey bird, he's standing there and he can see to the right, to the left, up above him, down below him, maybe a little bit behind him as well, just from that forward view.
Yes. And then when you watch birds, they make subtle changes to their head. They turn their head, just very subtle changes to their head allows that periscopic type vision.
Yeah, I know all about it. I saw that periscope the other day in the woods, and it yep. was quick. And that bird was gone.
Yep,
I understand that completely, because no doubt I am one of those predators out there. All right, very good. Brett, you got anything to add to that?
No, just the only thing I would add is that the color ramp that turkeys see in is not very well understood. We know that they tend to detect a little bit of UV better than humans do, but we don't actually understand what whatever we see, there's kind of a color ramp that we see in. We're not sure exactly what the color ramp they see in is. We just, because it's really kind of hard to ask them, what does this look like?
Sure, sure. Good content for sure. Great content. Kind of interesting. You're talking, Mike, about birds not being able to see as well at night. So this makes me thinking about a little bit of roost activity. So what tells birds, hey, it's time to go to roost? What makes them think, hey, we got to get up in a tree? Is it predators? Is it because it's getting dark? Maybe they've been bugging all day, got a full belly. Are they trying to go up for that? Tell me what your thoughts are on why these birds are hitting the roost.
Well, I mean, if you think about it, the only reason a 20-pound bird would sleep in a tree is because it's concerned with predation risk. So you combine the fact that if they sleep on the ground, they're predator fodder, and the fact that they don't see as well at night. And the best place for you to be is off the ground where most things that hunt you are at. So as far as like what drives their roosting, hey, it's time to roost. I mean, we've always assumed it's just, hey, it's starting to get dark, let's go. But we do know that turkeys, at least younger birds, will become hyperphagic before they roost. They'll eat a lot. That's also common, and you see this, and if you're a turkey hunter and you've ever gotten on a tom late in the evening, and it seems like he just has an agenda, like, I'm going where I'm going, you do tend to see increased foraging by adults as well just prior to roost, which makes sense. They're about to fast all night, and particularly for toms, a lot of times they're going to fast and then fly down and not eat. So it makes sense to kind of recover some of that before they roost.
Sure, sure. Brett, you got anything to add?
No, that's a good answer.
Thanks, man.
No problem, buddy.
Thanks.
Well, hey, I'm going to go ahead and turn the tides a little bit because we know roosting birds, we think they're protected from predators, right? But I do know that you guys have been doing some research, and that may not necessarily be true. Just kind of curious, you know, when these birds are sitting up on the roost, high up in a tree, maybe in a swamp, sitting over an old cypress pine, what could their predator be at that point?
Well, I mean, most of the time when these birds are up in the roost, they're, as Mike has said, they're really well protected. You know, most of your mammalian predators typically aren't going to get up in the trees after them. I mean, I have seen on occasion a bobcat up a tree or something along those general lines, but it's not going to be a kind of usual activity for them. You know, they're going to be hunting and foraging on the ground. And I'm sure Mike will get into this because I know he's seen some pictures as well, but owls and some of your larger raptors will take turkeys. Now, owls are rough on turkeys. They will take them right out of the tree. They'll hit them when they're on the ground, whenever the females are nesting, which I think we'll get into another night. But owls will take birds out of trees pretty easy. We've got some evidence that some of your hawks will take roosting poults. I've lost a few poults that we've had tags on at night and found them in red-tailed hawk nests the next day, whenever my students have been out tracking them. But I think that the primary roost predator that we're going to see is going to be owls. So, Mike, you concur with that?
Yeah, there's no question. Great horned owls are throughout the species range. Where you see horned owls and turkeys of any subspecies overlap, they are a prominent predator of both adults, females and males, as well as poults. I mean, horned owls, if you have any experience with them, they are ultimate predators. They can hit birds in the tree. They can, like Brett said, they can hit them on the ground, and they're powerful enough and they're silent upon approach. So the bird has no idea that they're about to be hit. So if you think about it, and what horned owls do is when they attack, they hit the neck head area. So you typically see a bird that's decapitated by horned owls, or they have really severe damage to their neck area. But a lot of times the telltale sign is they decapitate the bird as soon as they get it to the ground.
Well, that's pretty morbid, really. What about barred owls? I mean, we all out barred owl calling and trying to get those birds to gobble in the morning. What are they impacting birds?
We don't lose a lot of birds to barred owls. And I'll be honest with you, Jason, years ago there was work published saying that researchers had lost a few to barred owls. And I personally at the time thought it was kind of hogwash. I was like, come on, man. an owl this big. Nah, it's not. But we do know what happens. I've seen pictures of barred owl kills where the owl was still attached to the turkey. It's crazy scenarios, but it's not nearly as common as horned owls.
Right.
Yeah, good answer. Appreciate that. Yeah, we had a question from Ryan Berthelot about owls, so I think you nailed that really well. A great question out there. We did have another question just popped up, and it was about some of the eyesight, et cetera, and how well can turkeys see at night and during the day, and then also with colors? Just trying to get a feel for all that.
Go ahead, Brett.
Okay, yeah. Well, with colors, they can see colors pretty well, but the ramp is different. So they don't exactly see, like what we call blue, it might still be generally blue, but maybe a completely different shade of blue or green or something like that. Mike talked a little bit about, you know, their monocular periscopic vision and how they get depth perception by the continuous bobbing of their head, moving it around because their eyes are located on the side, and that helps them measure distance to things. We're unclear really on what colors they actually see. We do know that they have a as most birds do, a pretty high ability to see things different UV scales. So they do actually notice UV a little bit brighter, so to speak. But they can see. Now, on distance, during the day, they've got pretty good sight. Now, I can't remember the study, but there was one that was done on some captive birds that looked at it and said that they were able to notice movement outside of about 100 yards. But that's in an open field with nothing around and those type of things. At night, that number gets pulled way in, because they don't have the light gathering capability in their eyes. So you can assume that at night that bird's probably, inside of, maybe, 50 meters, 40 meters at best. And the darker it is, the more difficult it's going to be for it to see. Mike, you got anything you want to add?
Yeah, I would just say we assume they see colors because they respond to color changes on their own heads. But we don't, like Brett said, we don't know that, like, the red, white, and blue that we cherish on a tom's head is actually red, white, and blue to them. It may be some other sequence of colors or different contrast. We just assume they see those colors because they respond to those colors, and the colors can change, but that's pretty much an unknown.
Yeah, 10-4. Yeah, good information, no doubt. I mean, I always look at the old Mr. Tom out there as our symbol of the American flag, Mr. Red, White, and Blue. I mean, sure. No doubt. Great to see that out there this time of the year, for sure. So let's talk a little bit about maybe birds in a flock, and talking about, how is that effective with predators? Is that an advantage to have a lot of birds flocking up together? Are there differences you guys see, and if that could be better or worse from a predation standpoint? And even thinking about north, south, and weather conditions, how does all that kind of play into effect? I know I just put a lot of things out there for you, so digest a little bit of it and give me what you got.
You want to go on this one, Mike?
Sure. I mean, more is better. That's the bottom line. Turkeys are gregarious. They are a flocking, social animal. They have their entire social system is built around being around each other. So they need safety in numbers. The more eyes, the better. And I mean, that makes sense. Turkeys are most vulnerable when they're by themselves. Yeah. So if they've got a partner, or better yet, 50 partners standing there that can help detect danger, better. When you start getting lower numbers, fewer eyes, and when you only have two eyes, even though they have tremendous vision, they're at a disadvantage relative to when they're in flocks.
So you're telling me when I call in a single gobbler, I got a better chance at harvest than calling in five?
I did not say that.
All right, I had to ask.
No. All
right, very good.
Sometimes when you have multiple toms, you're actually at an advantage because you can play to some of their aggressiveness amongst themselves. And sometimes you can get away with some things that I have that I couldn't have gotten away with if there were just one standing there, because they were preoccupied with each other rather than just me.
Sure.
Yeah, the only thing I'd add to what Mike said there is that, after kind of reproductive season ends, almost all these birds kind of congregate back up into a smaller flock of various sizes. And whenever we're monitoring survival of the birds with tags on our various males and females, we pretty infrequently find dead birds in the fall. And the worst period for mortality is not September through December. So, so I think that then that's the time that they're all just kind of hanging out. So I think that that's when the birds are, all flocked together in gregarious, that we just don't see any mortality. I mean, there's a little bit here and there, but just not much.
Hey, would you guys think we might have a little bit more mortality on toms during the breeding season due to them displaying and maybe been a little bit stupid because they've waited all year long to entice a lady? And do you think that is a disadvantage?
Oh, yeah. I mean, yeah. The ladies are the downfall. Yeah, I mean, we don't lose toms by and large. We don't lose toms except during when they start gobbling through the end of the breeding period. That's when they get smoked, whether it be from human predators or natural predators, because they're exhibiting risky behavior. Yeah. Like Brett said, as soon as the breeding season's over, we all know this. Every turkey hunter or person that walks around the woods, you start seeing toms group back up as soon as breeding season's over, and they get back in those social groups, those hierarchies that they have been in for some period of time, and they help protect each other with those eyes and their hearing. So, yeah, when the breeding season starts and they start acting on impulses, that's when it goes awry, if you will.
Yeah, no offense to all the males out there, but, you know, males get kind of stupid when ladies are around. And
not kind of.
Part of really. To the really. High extreme. All right, gotcha. Yeah, yeah, I totally agree. Totally agree. Remember those days. All right, very good. Good answers. We're getting a few questions rolling in at the moment. May try to go ahead and knock a couple of those out as far as when they're rolling in. And here's a question on does nest predator trapping have a meaningful effect on turkey populations? Mr. Chris Rice.
It depends on what you define as meaningful. Across a broad scale, likely not, unfortunately. Because this comes down to not so much the question of trapping. It comes down to the question of the diversity of predator species that are out there. One of the more common but less recognized things that, you know, predates nests is snakes. Rat snakes are a pretty big predator of turkey nests, eating eggs. Cause nest failure, and as far as I know, nobody's trapping snakes, or at least not very much. Some people have stated that, you know, localized trapping does have an effect. There's several organizations that are engaged in it from a research perspective, but I don't think that there's any very strong evidence that shows that trapping activities are going to, you know, regularly increase production at a biologically meaningful scale. That said, you know, trapping is a fantastic sport and an excellent recreational opportunity, and, you know, nobody's against it. It probably doesn't add a whole bunch of colts to the table, you know, every year. So,
Mike, you don't have anything to add? Because I got something to add once you're done.
Yeah, I would just say that, I mean, from a trapping perspective, to Brett's point, you know, there's a lot of things that eat turkey nest. When I get this question, I start asking, what size property do you have? Where are you at in the United States or elsewhere, so that I can understand the predator community? If it's extremely diverse, like it is in the deep South, you got a tough road. Is that to say that you cannot have impacts to nest success? No. If you do long-term sustained trapping on site and remove a broad suite of mammalian predators, you could, in certain situations, see some type of response. Now, whether it's biologically relevant to Brett's point, it could be 5% increase. It could be a 10% increase. We don't know. And it's because there's so many things out there that eat a turkey egg. And you also, with a lot of these predators, you see very dramatic population level responses when you reduce density, such as with coyotes.
Wow.
Other animals like bobcats that have land tenure where they maintain territories that are the same through time, you can have a dramatic effect on those populations because they're not backfilling constantly like, say, coyotes would be. And then you start talking about the smaller mammals like raccoons. There are more raccoons out there than you think there are because their social structure is such that you have males share home ranges, you have males den together. So you may have a situation where you have a couple of breeding females in an area and 8 or 10 or 12 or more males that are in groups of 4 or 5. So you go and you catch one and you think, well, I got him. No, you didn't. Likely you have one of several. That's more common in the South. You don't see that in all areas and all latitudes, but in the deep South, that is a very common behavior in raccoons. So the point is, it's not just a numbers game with some of these predators. It's a numbers game in combination with understanding a little bit about their ecology, so that when you do make decisions on, well, I'm going to go trap, how long are you going to trap? Are you going to engage your neighbors? What's your footprint? Those are all questions that I encourage people to ask and think about when you're starting to consider what is going to be a long-term committed process if you're going to try to have any measurable impact on your flocks.
I totally agree. That basic framework of always starting at the habitat level, you have to build that first. That's the foundation of the house for the turkey. And if we have good habitat in place first, then all of a sudden a sea of habitat provides that opportunity to escape predators and to increase survival over time. And then when we start pairing other activities or pull other tools out of the toolbox, such as trapping down the road, we have seen research in the quail arena, and especially in the deep South out of tall timbers. Some of the work that I saw when I worked down in Georgia, no doubt on places that were intensively trapped each year, removing a host of predators, they were seeing anywhere from a 15 to 20% increase in quail numbers in a year. And no doubt you can see the same measures with turkey birds. However, I will point out, just as you said, for the average landowner, it's a little bit different than someone that owns 20,000 acres that more than encompasses a home range for the wild turkey.
Yep.
So all these things come into play in the cost and the time and the effort and working with your neighbors. And how do you do this more effectively at a scale? So there's a lot to consider when we talk about predators and management, right?
Yep. Totally agree.
Very good. We got a question pop up here about snakes. Ronnie Fields said 40% of nest predation is from snakes. What snake breeds account for the majority of those losses?
Depends on where you are, but rat snakes, that general, I can't think of the genus off the top of my head. Somebody's going to yell at me over email about it. But you're kind of standard rat snakes that everybody sees out in the woods. Those guys they're rough. They're smart. And I heard this from a small herpetologist. But they're smart, and they'll look, and they'll figure out where things are going, and they'll follow. So the rat snake kind of group is pretty good. They do a pretty good hit on wild turkey loss. And you know, you'll get depending on where you're at, you know, indigo snakes or coach whips, or I mean, I've seen a rattlesnake eat an egg once. But the kind of general rat snake group is the, and I'm blanking on the genus for them, they're the ones that are, you know, the primary predators that we see within our turkey nests. So.
Yep.
Okay. Very good. All right. So moving on into predators in general, I mean, as far as in relatance to turkeys in general, when are the adults most vulnerable from predators?
When they're by themselves. So anytime they're alone. So for a hen, it's while she's incubating. By and large, we don't see much mortality at all outside of incubation. Occasionally we'll lose a bird before nesting starts. This year on one of our sites right down the road, we've lost a couple to owls. But most of the time, no, we don't really lose birds before or after incubation unless they hatch. Mm-hmm. So, and again, that is they're by themselves and they have a bunch of poults walking around with them, and that makes them susceptible to things that want to kill them. When they're in flocks, we, like Bret was saying, in the fall, and even in the summer, we see very, very little mortality once the reproductive period is over.
I mean, birds they're kind of stinky, right? I mean, I don't know how to better put that. And a lot of times folks will talk about, you know, the issues with rain in the spring. But if you're a bird dog hunter out there and you got dogs, no doubt scent is important. And it's something that's often overlooked, but we got a lot of rain on the ground. What does that do for scent?
Well, I mean, you just said it. If you're a bird dog guy or gal, you know it matters. I will say there's some conflicting evidence out there, and Bret, I know, is familiar with this. There's this notion that a wet hen is a dead hen type of thing, meaning when you get these persistent rain events, they stink a lot and predators eat them. And there's been some work showing that, but there's also been a lot of unequivocal type work. It just, you can see that really. I tend to think that it's more a function of the prevailing vegetative conditions around her and air movement and how that changes or does not change olfaction by predators. So, or is what I'm saying in simpler terms would be there are just some places that are better than others, and we don't really know how to tell that at this point. From a scent standpoint, I think there's probably just some areas that are just better, and there's a lot of places that are not good, and it doesn't matter what's standing around the nest per se. It's how air is moving around that nest and what is nearby that could funnel that scent to something that's walking around like a coyote or a bobcat or a raccoon. And if you think about it from the standpoint of what eats turkeys, like what we've been talking about, some of these predators don't hunt with their noses. Some of these predators hunt mostly with their eyes, like cats. And then others hunt primarily with their noses. You know, raccoons and coyotes they have tremendous sense of smell. So you stack all that together, and I say this a lot, it's tough being a turkey because you've got a lot of things out there that can smell you, but you've also got a lot of things out there that see you.
Good points.
That if we didn't have rain at the right time, you know, we wouldn't have all of this vegetation. And if you think about something like a Rio Grande, just using a Western bird as an example, you know, we want rain right before they nest and a little bit during nesting, because that basically causes those huge population pulses we see for Rios. And sorry if you hear the dogs barking. My bird dogs have decided that there's deer in the backyard. They're raising a pig downstairs. If you didn't have rain at the right times, we wouldn't have birds in some of these cases. So I tend to agree with Mike that I think the concept of olfaction is driven by the bird just happening to settle in a place where the wind doesn't quite push through as much or as often. So
very good. We got a quick question here from Wendell May. What age can a turkey live to in the wild? Stumper.
I'll do this one. So, on average, 3 years, 3.5 on average for most males, you know, and most females, it'll be about 3, 3.5. Most of your females, we lose about 30% of the females a year during the reproductive season to predation. So just 30% over 3 years is about, you know, 100%. Males, tend to, you know, get harvested, you know, during hunting season, and they don't tend to get predated by much else, but usually we tend to think somewhere around that 3.5 range is usually pretty good for them. Now, that said, and I don't remember the numbers from yours, Mike, the oldest one I've seen that was a guaranteed known age was, I think, 9. And I had caught it and banded it as a juvenile female. And then it was actually at the Kerr Wildlife Management Area, it was Rio. And caught it and banded it as a juvenile female 1 year, and then it was recaptured, I don't know, 9 years later. So it was actually known age. So we actually knew how old that bird was. That's the oldest one that I know of. Now, I'm sure there are others that have lived longer. There was one that you knew about, Mike, right?
Yeah. Yeah, there's two I can think of off the top of my head. One was a tom that was 8. And one was a hen that I saw, actually, back in the day when we used to put wing tags.
Wow, okay.
Birds. She showed up at a bait site on a study area that had been Mississippi State had been working on this site forever. And she showed up and one of her wing tags was gone and the other one was turned straight up in the air and was all weird colored from the sun. And when I read the number, I had no idea who it was. I had to actually go back to the database, but she was 10. And I didn't catch her. As an aside, she refused to walk over to the bait, and she actually spooked the whole group. She knew what was up. So, I still have a bad sense in my stomach about her. But anyway, she was 10, and she was still kicking. So,
all right. Once again, we've just proved that women are a little smarter than men. We'll leave it at that.
a lot smarter.
Agreed. All right, let's move on here, and we'll get a few more things into the discussion arena. One of these is I had a question just to try to stimulate some conversation around what type of predators focus on turkeys at their different life stages. So what kind of predators? We've heard a lot about nest predator already, snakes being the number one, but let's take that from poults until they become adults. Let's talk about that.
Yeah, so everything eats poults. Really?
Yeah.
Everything from snakes to your smaller mammals like raccoons. Now, it's important to consider that poults, every day they live, they get safer. So, you got a three-day-old poult, a lot of stuff eats them. The raccoons, all of your raptors, your owls, your cats, your foxes, your coyotes, all of that can account for poult death and brood loss. Once they get off the ground at day 12 to 14, depending on where you are, things get better. And then once they get to be like rooster size, chicken size, at that point, it's whatever kills mom. So whatever is an adult predator is generally, that's what's going to be a poult killer as well. And those are, as we've been talking about, the biggies are owls, bobcats, coyotes. That's the, and man, that's, or woman, sorry. those are the five that come to my mind. If we're going to lose an adult, it's going to be to a bobcat, to a horned owl, to a coyote, or to a gunshot. Sometimes, vehicle collisions, but that's humans as well. Other things can kill adults, but it's not often.
Yeah, you see some eagles occasionally popping in. I think I've seen a couple of big hawks slam into them, but those are the big ones that get after them for certain.
Yeah, back in the day, I used to tell folks, just like you said, anything will eat a small bird. I mean, everything's hungry and looking for a free meal, and if they stumble across it, it's going to happen. I mean, that's just part of it. So good way to hit on that. A lot of what you kept saying was people, right? Humans, and no doubt. I mean, we're in spring turkey season in most states. I know I've harvested a couple birds this year already, so I know I'm a primary predator, as are you guys. Tell us a little bit about this in relatance to wildlife management. And no doubt there's a reason why that we have regulations. We look at how many birds can be harvested and things like that in the different states. Tell us a little bit about why do we do this from region to region? What's important about that from some of that terminology?
You want this one, Mike? You want me to? No, go ahead.
Gosh, that's a
additive compensatory mortality. I'm thinking of that arena.
Okay. Yeah. So, and this is still a little up for debate, but most evidence suggests that harvest is additive, meaning if we don't shoot these birds, they live another year. There is some work out there suggesting that that's not true, but by and large, if you look across most of the literature on this bird, harvest during the spring is considered an additive source of mortality. So in other words, that bird doesn't die if we don't shoot it. That's typically not the case in your smaller game birds. In reality, Jason, what we're probably looking at with turkeys and most animals in general is that there's no such thing as solely additive or solely compensatory, meaning there's a doomed surplus. Like, so compensatory mortality would be there's a doomed surplus. If we don't harvest them, they're going to die anyway. And in reality, I think research on most birds, game birds, has found there's no such thing as literal either one of those. That there's, it's shades of gray, there's partial compensation, there's partial additivity. And I suspect that's the same in turkeys as well. But for the most part, we generally think that spring harvest is mostly additive across the board.
Okay. And when you think about just hunting in general for most species, that are, you know, most of our game species, obviously, I mean, that's pretty much the number one mortality source.
Yeah.
Annual cycle. I mean, it doesn't matter if we're talking about turkeys or deer or, you know, woodcock or grouse or ducks. I mean, lots of these critters get shot. And for turkeys, it just, that happens to be the kind of primary mortality source. The primary predator is us, especially on males. You know, it switches over for females whenever they go into nesting to all the things we've already talked about.
Yeah, and some of the things you see, and I've been asked this quite a bit. Some of what you see that tends to lead you to think maybe some of these birds would have died anyway, ergo compensatory mortality. A lot of that mortality occurs in the summer. And I'm admittedly a little skeptical of that because there are a lot of birds. We've all wounded birds. We've all thought we missed birds. And, you know, some work out of South Carolina survey data that the state does, about a quarter of all hunters surveyed reported wounding and or missing birds. And unless you take a shot at a fairly dramatic distance, most of the times you don't really miss. I mean, you have a shot cone that's quite large. So I tend to, when I see work that shows a lot of mortality in the summer, admittedly, I'm not casting shade here. I'm a little skeptical of that because we know that birds are being wounded and they don't die overnight. So I tend to think that the previous research showing it's additive, I tend to go with that.
Good to know. We got a question that popped up. We're going to try to address that. Mr. Todd Lowry, hogs or coyotes, which one do you think has the most effect on nesting?
Coyotes.
Mm-hmm.
Hands down. So coyotes are going to attempt to predate both the female, and they're obviously going to predate the nest if they get the opportunity. And there's been a lot of, so we can basically say no one is a fan of feral hogs. I think that everybody can generally agree on that. Mm-hmm. There's been a lot of discussion lately about whether or not feral hogs are a primary nest predator or not, meaning that they're effectively pushing females off of a nest and then eating the eggs. The answer to that's no. Female wild turkeys will defend their nest. And feral hogs aren't exactly the most aggressive things, contrary to what popular belief seems to be of the razorback running through the woods chasing down a guy. You know, they're flighty, and if something bows up on them, so to speak, they tend not to just mess with it just to mess with it. They'll go find their meal somewhere else. Coyotes are going to eat the hen. They're going to eat the eggs. Pigs typically show up on our digital trail cameras on nests after the nest has been predated by something else. You know, coyote gets in there, a raccoon, a snake, something that, you know, will push the hen off. Snakes tend to eat all the eggs, so the hen leaves, but something that pushes the hen off because it could eat her. Then the pigs will usually come in and swoop in and kind of clear it up. There's been a lot of work done lately with what we call artificial nests or dummy nests, where folks go out and put little clusters of eggs on the landscape, and set cameras on them and then use that to identify what's predated the nest sites. I've done it. It's a very common tool that we use, but it gives a little bit of a artificial representation of how a nesting female and her behaviors to keep predators off of her nest that she's not afraid of have an impact on nest predation. So I've never seen a feral pig be the primary nest predator of any nest that we've monitored in my career. They're always there second or third. Mike, I don't know if you want to follow up on that, but
yeah, we see, I can recall one that a GPS marked bird that we know for certain lost its clutch due to feral pigs. To Brett's point is an important point. Now, this is not to say pigs are good. Pigs
No.
Terrible.
Yes.
But pigs are not coyotes. Coyotes hunt in a way, they forage in a way that lends themselves nicely to interacting with turkeys. They have tremendous eyesight and they smell incredibly well. They're a coursing predator and they move fast. And as such, they can cover a lot of ground. And feral pigs don't do that. So although pigs move a lot, they don't move quickly in general. They kind of move around more slowly. The second thing is that to Brett's point, coyotes will not only kill the attending adult, but if they don't kill the attending adult and they flush her off the nest, they're going to eat the eggs. I mean, it's guaranteed. So I tend to look at it as like, well, it's double-edged sword there. The other thing to think about, at least in the deep south, and this would not apply in bottomland forest, true bottomland forest, like alluvial type forest. But in upland forest, our turkeys are not nesting where pigs are hanging out in the spring and summer, because a lot of your feral pig activity tends to be in more lowland areas, particularly once it starts to dry out. And our birds rarely ever nest in those areas. Now, when you get in bottomland sites, that's not the case. But on more upland sites, we typically don't see a lot of pig activity in areas where they're nesting compared to, say, your mammalian-type predators like coyotes and cats.
Sure. Good answer, guys. If we're looking at things regionally, as far as predators go, do you think turkeys are more vulnerable in the north or the south or east or west, or any thoughts, or is it where there's a more diversity of predators that could be harder on birds?
If I was a betting man, I would say that probably birds are more vulnerable in the south as opposed to the Midwest and the kind of, Central Plains regions of the United States. I can't really speak elegantly to the Northeast, other than some of the previous work that's been done. But the diversity of things that eat nests is higher in the South. Just the absolute number of different species that'll predate a nest is just higher. It's just numerically higher once you get south of, about the Mason-Dixon line. It just goes up. You have a wider diversity, a wider array of snakes, a wider array of ground, mammal predators, wider array of avian predators. So I would think that in the south is probably higher densities and higher species richness, I think might be the right term. In general, yeah.
So okay.
Now that said, just because a predator, and Luke, we may get to this, but just because a predator gets near a nest doesn't mean the nest gets predated. That's a real important point to bring across here, is that a lot of things will get really close to the nest and just not touch them.
Sure. I think that's a great point, for sure. And yeah, if you want to expand on any of that, hey, let's roll with it. You open the door.
Yeah, I'll do this one. Yeah, so we had a weird situation with a Goulds a few years back, working with the Arizona Game of Fish folks and some colleagues out there, Jim Heffelfinger being the primary one. We got fortunate and had this Goulds back up against a tree right on the outside of a creek. And I mean, absolutely no cover. It was like your kid put a soccer ball in the landscaping at the base of a tree. You could see it from every direction that you looked. And this bird was sitting on the nest, and she was right next to what turned out to be a trail that was actively used by bears. So we had tons of pictures of bears walking by. They had quaddies, which is a species that exists down there in Arizona, bebopping along, foxes. And just to talk about the nuances of predation that we don't always understand, a fox, and we have photographs of this, and if anybody's interested, I'm sure that we can get them to you guys to post, but we had a fox that stuck its head underneath a nesting hen. We can only assume that it was trying to get at the eggs, did not try to predate the hen, and it came back multiple nights, and the female never moved. And she then hatched that nest successfully. She had bears within 5 feet of her multiple times. Wow. And there's absolutely no vegetation. For those people that have seen the pictures, there is nothing there. So you know, it goes back to, I think, what Mike was saying earlier about the idea that there are just some places where the birds get lucky and the air flows just right. But there's also things that we don't know about. I mean, I have always assumed that if a fox finds a turkey nest, either the turkey's dead or the nest is dead. And this is the strangest thing I've ever seen in my life. I sent it to some friends, and Mike saw it. We can still, I don't think, can figure it out. I mean, Mike, what do you think about it?
Yeah, I mean, I posted that picture of that bear walking by that hen on social media, and I mean, people couldn't believe it. I couldn't believe it. Some people. I mean, it's like, why would she possibly sit there? She knew something we didn't. I mean, she clearly did not see those animals as a risk to her. There's a lot we don't understand about predation, and I think if you're a deer hunter and you run trail cameras all the time, you're seeing the same thing we are. You know, I'm doing a camera survey this past fall, and I have pictures with coyotes and deer standing at the same camera, and they're watching each other. Now, clearly, there's something we don't understand about that, because that's an animal that kills deer readily, adults and fawns. Yet here's a matriarchal group of does with yearlings standing around watching two coyotes 20 yards from them. So there's a lot we don't know about the actual process of predation and how it occurs. We just know what does it, but we don't understand a lot about how it actually occurs.
Yeah, it's interesting. I know I have walked really close. I remember being out in Nebraska and coming up on a Merriam's bird and sit on the nest, and she would not move. And I literally could have reached down and grabbed her. But I don't know if she just thought she was still in that cryptic camouflage and she felt safe. And I just backed off, and I didn't realize I'd even stepped up that close to her. So it is interesting how these critters seem to adapt to the environment and no matter what the predator is. So who knows? Hard to imagine what they're thinking in that little bitty brain they have, right?
Yeah.
For sure. All right, I got a quick question here. They got thrown out from let's see here, Alan. Which eats more ticks, possums or turkeys? And then let's ask the question after that. Do we get rid of the possum instead of the turkey or what? Alan Morris, thank you.
I don't know. Yeah,
Alan, that's a tough question.
Yeah. I've seen some forest studies on pest rates, but I don't know, Mike.
I'm sitting here. The definitive on this would be Bill Healy's dissertation.
Yeah.
And who imprinted birds and then watched them forage and very carefully detailed their foraging behaviors and what they ate. And I don't recall ticks being that prominent at all. I do know that he reported them occurring, but nothing close to say grasshoppers and spiders. And so I'm going to give the thumbs up to a possum.
Yeah. I'm on that one.
I mean, yeah, and I teach students in classes. I mean, opossums have more teeth than any mammal, right, in North America, and they have 10 incisors. So there's a reason that they have all those little, you know, those little incisors that look like rice kernels. It's because they're eating things like ticks. So go possums, man.
I support possums as well. No doubt they can be a nest predator. But, you know, thinking about this holistically, if there's a little bit of habitat management in place, in places I've been, the deep south, boy, you just don't have any tick problems when there's a little prescribed fire on the ground. So it may be a topic to talk about in the future, but no doubt, I think all that kind of plays together in predators, some of those critters that we don't like, the blood-sucking insects out there like ticks, and I think that's something we'll address in a future episode and dive into maybe fire effects.
Yep.
All right, got another quick question here before we move on. Mr. Skip Steele, I believe. Let's throw that out there. I've heard coyotes mentioned as nest and adult turkey predators. Heard biologists say that the coyote nest and adult predation is not significant when compared to the other predators. I've also heard that they affect the behavior of the turkey more than actual predation. Thoughts? Go.
Michael, you're the coyote guy. I'll turn this one over to you.
Yeah, so Skip may be referencing me. We don't see relative to, now this is relatively speaking, and that's an important caveat here, relative to other animals. Coyotes on our populations in the South are not as important as owls and cats. Do they kill turkeys? Absolutely. Yes, they kill turkeys. We know that. And in some populations, they are an important form of mortality. Work on Merriam's in South Dakota has shown coyotes are an important source of mortality. I worked on a site in Mississippi where coyotes and bobcats were, I mean, it's like they were in a competition. They were running neck and neck. I lost a bunch of birds to coyotes in that study. But across our populations, relative to cats and horned owls, they're not as impactful. What I think, I think there's probably a lot of anecdotal information out there that supports this, that hunters that I talk to, I've seen it with my own eyes, is coyotes harass things. And if you watch coyotes and how they forage, sometimes they don't attack, they just harass. And canids in general do this, that use group foraging strategies like coyotes can do. They don't have to. They can hunt alone. But coyotes are capable of feigning attempts at prey and harassing prey. And that harassment, as we know, dysfunctions in a bunch of prey species, causes stress. And that stress causes a perceived risk. So a bird looks at a coyote. He or she doesn't know that the coyote is not going to kill them or try to kill them, but it's still a risk. And that is a chronic type stress. And that's, Skip may be referring to, and I've been quoted as saying this before. I personally think looking at how canids function in general, that it's not just a killing event when we talk about coyotes in the South. I think it's a killing and a harassment and a perception of the bird. That's a potential risk to me. Therefore, I'm going to alter my behavior or I'm going to be more alert. I'm going to pay more attention. And if that is the case, then coyotes may be having an important indirect effect on turkeys beyond just killing them, if that makes sense. So I think that potential exists that doesn't exist in some other species, such as cats. Turkeys don't know cats are there until they're there. Right? They don't know a horned owl is there until it hits, but they know a coyote's there. If they can, because coyotes use open areas in general, early successional areas like turkeys do, and coyotes use their eyes and their nose. And to do that, they need to be able to smell air that's above vegetation, right? That's flowing. So if you think about it, these two animals use a lot of the same areas and they have the same strategies to go about their lives. And therefore, I think there's potential that just their interactions could be an impact to birds beyond just them killing turkeys.
Sure. Good answer. Good answer. Hey, we've got another great question. We have a professional on here, Miss Michael Klein, the Upland Bird Game Bird Coordinator for the Oregon Department of Fish and Wildlife. Here's the question. I often use weather and habitat variables to explain annual variation in wild turkey numbers. What advice can you give to incorporate predator dynamics into spring turkey forecast?
A good math question. So how do we integrate what we know about predator populations in general into forecasting population size in subsequent years before hunting seasons for regulatory management? There was some really good work done in the early 2000s that looked at the relationship between the poult per hen indices and some of the trapping data and the survey data that had occurred for a variety of predatory species in Texas. There's been several. I'm a little bit unsure offhand without thinking about it for more than 30 seconds what the clear link would be, the modeling structure you need to put in to bring in a effective predation, because typically how that's manifested is accounted for whenever you get to the point where you're counting poults, because most of your predation has occurred before you get to where you're actually counting the poults, because by that time they're, you know, chicken size or they're bigger, so they're not actually dying anymore. I'm gonna have to think about it and email you on that one there, because there's potentially some mechanisms to do it with some of the integrated population models that people are using now for taking multiple data sources and predicting them, but that's a little bit dense for, I think, tonight. Mike, you got any thoughts that I'm missing on that?
No, I was just about to say the integrated models, that's a potential, but it's a heavy topic. I think the question is great, because I think it would be useful for agencies to consider incorporating data sets that aren't just turkey productivity,
yep,
or just aren't turkey harvest or hunter effort, et cetera, into their decision-making processes. How we do that quantitatively and then make sense of it in a way that can inform management quickly, that's where people like Bret, that's where they make their money. That's where Mike says, go for it, Bret.
I'll figure out how to get in touch with you since you're watching. We'll make
it. So this sounds like one that we're going to have to table for a bit. Y'all can pour a drink after hours, discuss this thing, get it worked out. We'll be good. Yep. All right. Very good. All right. We're going to move on. We've covered a lot of things, and I'm going to just kind of throw a sideline in here, you know, because I can do that. If we had to have a preference on what type of predator we want, and knowing that coyotes been a lot of this discussion and pretty popular. I've even seen some social media feeds recently of coyotes carrying off adult birds, et cetera. But kind of curious, you know, if we had to have a predator, would it be better to have a coyote or a fox or a bobcat? And what are those predator dynamics when it all works together, so to speak? Yeah.
I don't want any of them. don't take that wrong. Yeah. So from the fox is the least of your concerns. In areas where you have coyotes, where they're sympatric, meaning they're living together with coyotes, you don't have foxes.
Right.
What we see with red foxes is coyotes spatially exclude them and they kill them. They kill the adults and the pups. We know that gray foxes are also killed directly by coyotes. Gray foxes can climb, so they can get away from coyotes. But the work we've recently published, this is some work that I've been involved with for a number of years, as gray foxes seem to be living in areas where there's human beings. They're really closely tied to infrastructure and human dwellings and us. And that makes sense, because that's the only place left that is not saturated with coyote territories. So foxes, not bad. if you're asking me to pick coyotes or cats, if I'm a turkey, I'm taking coyotes
all day long
because cats are efficient killers, and cats use a hunting strategy that undermines the defense system that a turkey has. Cats do just like your cat at home. They sit and they wait, and they move short distances and they forage, and then they wait, and they move short distances and they wait. And what they're trying to do is get to an area where they're encountering a certain number of prey, and then they stop and they start doing what we see cats do, which is very carefully moving through their environment and hunting. If you're a turkey, that takes your that takes some things that are vitally important to you. One being your sight, and two being able to hear where stuff is coming from, and it completely negates that. So I'm taking a coyote all day long. If and I know this is like, damn, it's like, God, if the bird can see, if the bird can see, they have the advantage. But when you put turkeys in habitat that they're not adapted to being in, which is any habitat that they can't see in, then it doesn't matter. The predator has an advantage they would otherwise not have. But I'm taking coyotes. If it's comparing to bobcats, cats are killers. And we lose a lot of turkeys to bobcats in all of our populations across the U.S. Everywhere where bobcats occur, they kill turkeys.
Yeah, great answer. That is, and it's strictly because I've got actual video of it. A coyote can hit a bird sitting on the nest, and the bird can scoot out from it before the coyote can get mouth on it. I've got video of it, video in the nest, and the coyote comes slamming in to try and grab it, and the bird just kicks loose. I don't have any video of bobcats letting birds get away. I got a few videos of bobcats catching birds. So I'm with Mike. I'm taking coyotes all the way.
Yeah, cats.
All right, sorry, cats, guys. I had to throw y'all that curveball. Have a little fun with you. Yeah. It is still cocktail hour, at least for me. So the questions may get a little more lively as time goes by. All right, we got a question from outside here. Duke Turnage. Is there any data on domestic dogs and cats as far as predator impacts? This falls right in line with cats. Go, boys.
I don't know about most cats. There's just your standard domestic cat. They're not really positioned to take on a turkey. They're a little too small, and they're not. They're going to be out chasing smaller birds and lizards and that kind of jazz. I've had a few nests predated by domestic dogs, not adults. I've had nests fail because of domestic dogs. But it's not a bunch. It's a few here and there. We have nests in people's yards that have dogs that, you know, run around and don't mess with them, but not an enormous amount, but definitely I'm a no on the domestic cats.
Sure.
Yeah, I think dogs could be problematic in places. And if you are on Instagram a lot, Steve Rinella has been posting some videos the last week or so of domestic groups of domestic dogs attacking deer. Mm-hmm. I see, in fact, the property I was hunting on this morning, we're walking along, going back to the truck, great hunt, successful, happy. And I'm watching coyote tracks in the road. And all of a sudden there's domestic dog tracks and there's three sets. And I'm thinking to myself, and those are large dogs. And I don't see any dogs just running around. These are not pet dogs that are on this farm. That's concerning to me. And we know that they attack. I think it's probably common sense to think when given the chance, they'd attack and harass turkeys as well.
Yep.
We can't quantify it. We don't have the data to answer the question, but I certainly think it's conceivable.
Sure. Yeah, good answers, guys. We got another question popped up, and I really liked the question because I was thinking about this. Mr. Cody Seagraves, are there any buffer prey species that take some pressure off turkeys, similar to the cotton rats and quail, where the cotton rats have an influence on the type of predators coming in, such as red tail hawks as opposed to Coopers, et cetera?
There was some work done on that in East Texas about 8 years ago now, I guess it was. It was Hamish's work, if I remember right, Mike. And not really to the level that you saw with the quail. There's some quantification of the variety of species that were out there relative to turkeys, but there wasn't any real evidence that it just mitigated. There weren't any pulses seen in the small mammals or anything that would mitigate against turkey nest depredation. Some of that probably has to do with the fact that turkeys are generally at a fairly low abundance in that region of East Texas. So there weren't as many turkey nests on the landscape. And some of that probably had to do with the fact that there weren't a significant number of pulses in the small mammal community, which is what I think the quail literature found, where they saw the pulses in the small mammal communities and concomitant declines in quail nest predation. That's the only one that I'm really familiar with that's looked at any sort of buffering. And I'm sure it occurs. I'm certain it occurs in certain places where a predator gets satiated and, you know, doesn't hunt as far or as intensively. And if it all turns right and overlaps, then yeah, it could definitely happen.
I'd say, Cody, that's a good question, which is good. He's a former UGA grad. I'd say no, not nearly as prominent as with bobwhites. And the reason is that, you know, cotton rats are a primary prey source of a lot of things that eat quail. And turkeys are not a primary prey source of anything. So I think there's probably, like to Brett's point, there's probably some potential for buffering in certain landscapes, particularly where prey communities are different than they are in the Southeast. But turkeys are so incidental in the diets of most of these animals compared to everything else they eat. I don't see that there's strong potential for buffering, at least in the South.
Let me throw this out there to you guys. Cicada hatches. Now, if we want to talk about predator-prey dynamics and some changes in comparison to cotton rats, could that be one of them?
I'm going to have to walk away because I got that paper sitting on my desk right now. So I'm going to Okay.
I'm good with you stepping down. I'm tossing this over to Mike then.
So is the question, could the cicada pulse be positive or negative?
Could cicada hatches change predator-prey dynamics where there's less pressure from predators upon poults because there's a lot of food out there? Now, yotes are eating cicadas. Raccoons are picking up cicadas. All these other predators that may be focused on turkeys now have an abundant food source that's going to be here quick and gone, and they're gobbling it up, and all of a sudden there's a little less pressure out there. A lot of discussion in those arenas. We see very large increases in turkey numbers post-cicada hatches. Some of that, no doubt, due to a lot of food on the ground, but right. a lot of anecdotal thoughts on shifts in predator-prey dynamics. Just curious what you guys think.
Kim Smith at Arkansas. Do you remember his work?
Yeah,
that'd be the one with looking at the corvids foraging way back in the 90s. I covered, if you don't want. Yeah, so
I'm a little skeptical because I'm sitting here thinking, like, things that eat poults that don't eat cicadas, there's a lot of them.
Yeah. But there is some prey switching with cicadas, you know, because most of your corvids and some of your small and mid-sized mammals actually they do switch.
Yeah. Yeah, and maybe it's like a synergistic type thing, too. You may have slight changes in predation pressures coupled with dramatic increases in foraging success of turkeys because these cicadas are out there. So maybe, I don't know, as I sit here thinking about it kind of on the spot, maybe there's some type of interaction there that it's not just one or the other. It's kind of a combination.
I personally think it's a cumulative effect.
Yeah.
And so when you have those kind of actions occur, I think it's so large that we are seeing, and it's well noted in most of the states that have hatches, we see increases in turkey numbers, but it could be just a multitude of things. So just some things to talk about or maybe future research.
It's sitting on my desk.
All right. Sounds good. All right, we're going to move on. We may try to get a few more questions in here, and then we'll try to wrap up, and I'll throw some stuff out to the general audience just to see how they may influence what we're going to talk about in the upcoming weeks. That sounds good to you guys.
Sure.
We ain't talked a whole lot about raccoons yet. Just kind of curious, you know. I mean, tell us a little bit about raccoons, and, you know, are they just lucky to find a nest, or, I mean, what's – is it a learned behavior, or what's going on there?
No, it's not learned. We did some really good experimental work nearly a decade, where we set up experiments where we could watch raccoons forage in the wild. And once we figured out what they actually do when they forage, like, what is the spatial data? What is the point locations? What does that look like? We then went and compared what we know was foraging raccoons to what raccoons did in areas where turkeys were nesting. And what we found is that they did not exhibit that behavior in areas where turkeys were nesting. They just happened to be in areas where turkeys were nesting. So it led us to infer that what's really probably happening is literally more of a random process. The raccoon is moving through its environment. It catches a whiff. He or she may be heading somewhere else to forage on whatever, and they catch a scent and they go looking for whatever that scent is. So they didn't get up that afternoon and say, you know what? A dozen eggs would be.
But, I think about that.
But if they smell a dozen eggs, they're going to get six or eight of them right off the bat. So no, the evidence we have from that work, which has been widely cited actually, is that no, they don't go looking for nests. They just happen to bump into them, or, you know, raccoons have an excellent sense of smell, so they don't have to just bump into it. They can smell it from some distance. And then once they detect it, they go find it.
So they're very opportunistic.
They are, and they're very good at their jobs. Raccoons, oh, yeah. Look at their foraging rates. They spend a lot of time in small areas. Once they detect prey, what we found in this work was once they detected the bait that we had there, they found it without question. They were going to find it because they coursed their environment back on their own tracks, zigzag back and forth through the environment to the point where if there's a nest there and they smell it, it's gone. They're going to find it.
I saw a question pop up that goes back to something Mike said about raccoons not searching. And the question was on crows, and I don't remember who put it up there. I'm apologizing for scrolling. Corvids, things like crows, they do look for nests, and they will actually follow. And I can't remember if that was the exact question, but there it is. Yeah, how bad are crows on the hen's nest? So some of these species we talk about are happenstance. You know, they're moving through the landscape and they just happen to intersect where a bird is or get close enough and they recognize it. A crow or a raven, there's a lot of evidence that they will actually sight in on an adult that's off on a recess movement, foraging, defecating, getting some water, and actually follow that individual back in. And then either attempt to move the individual off the nest. Turkeys are usually pretty aggressive at keeping crows off of them, or get in whenever the turkey happens to leave the nest, which we do see some evidence for. Well, they'll sneak in, grab an egg when the turkey's off the nest, and run off and go somewhere else. So I think they will do a job on a turkey nest, and they'll actually go back every day. They'll go back and pick another egg up as fast as they can. So,
yeah, crows are as we know, are relative to a lot of birds, are pretty intelligent, and if you're a turkey hunter and you've paid attention, you know this. Crows follow and mob and harass birds. This morning, a hen walks by us and we're waiting on the tom, and those crows are following that hen. They, I mean, absolutely following that hen, bobbing the tom out in the field. So to Brett's point, crows, they use their eyes and they're intelligent enough to be able to kind of track these birds. So there's a lot of evidence that they can end up finding clutches by patterning or seeing birds walking back and forth to a nest.
All right. I'm going to have one more question for you. We're going to go for an hour, but man, we've been having good questions roll in. So we're just rocking and rolling here today. And I got a little bit of drink left. I'm having to baby this thing, so I don't have to leave for long. But
boo-hoo.
I got one for you guys. Y'all ready?
Yeah.
I hope you're ready. All right. And I'm going to relate this to some research or work out of Missouri on a long-term study of looking at predator numbers and tracking this back during the time when trapping was at its epic high. And just kind of curious on your thoughts on how the turkey population has evolved over the history of time since all of the releases were done, et cetera. And do you think that when those fur prices were really high back in the day, if that broad scale trapping efforts helped us really grow the turkey population?
I don't think there's any question that landscape level declines in trapping have had some impact on mesocarnivore or carnivore communities, and ergo it has to have some effect on turkeys. The confounding issue there is that we have created landscapes that are better for predators than turkeys.
Yeah.
So just the absence of a trapper on the landscape is not the fix that it would have been 30 years ago, because the landscapes that we've created are better for them than the bird. I mean, that we've fragmented habitat. We've created more simple agricultural systems that are easier to course by predators. We've created environments that are brushy and shrubby and woody, which benefits species like rat snakes and raccoons. So to your point, Jason, yes, I think the loss of the trapping trade wasn't a positive for turkeys, but fixing that would not be as simple as just having that trade. If raccoon pelts were all of a sudden $40 a pelt, people would start trapping again, probably, but it would not be the same ball game that it was in 1980.
And I think that an additional confounding in that is that in 1980, we were restoration and post-restoration, and we were seeing significant population growth rates. There weren't as many top-down turkeys as there are now with related space and availability. So I agree with Mike and what he said in that it's not going to have – there's going to be some impact, and it's probably going to be positive. But there were a lot of other things going on at that time that we don't actually have going on now, such as wide open landscapes where we were putting birds back into, and they were able to effectively grow and reproduce uninterrupted. You didn't have density dependent responses, you know, where population size reaches a certain level and there's just no more space, which we do see in certain cases and we've got some concerns about. So I think that it was uniquely kind of that perfect storm when two things that are occurring at the same time, it's the whole causation question. So I don't think it couldn't hurt, but I don't think that it's a panacea towards, you know, going back to everybody trapping and we're going to have turkeys across the landscape again. I think Mike's right on the underlying landscape has changed too much.
Okay. Good discussion, gentlemen. Any remarks, anything to kind of close this out on your side on today, anything you want to hit on?
I would just say, predation is one of the things that we get asked the most about. I mean, if I were to look at my inbox on any given day, I'm getting questions about predation, harvest, fire, habitat, those four things. That's the four biggies that fill up my box. Predation, you know, we're going to talk about a lot of these topics over the next 5 or 6 weeks. Predation is by far one of the more complex issues this bird faces because we lack an understanding of not only the bird and how they perceive their environment, but we also we don't fully understand these predator communities either. We're still learning a lot about these animals. So as we talked about, you know, weather and all these things that can influence the probability of a bird dying on this day, that's a complex question. So unlike some of the other things that we're going to talk about that have solutions that may be more tangible, predation's a tough one, man. It's complex and it kind of makes your head hurt. But it's questions you have to ask because it's an important influence on this bird's populations across the landscape. There's no question.
Yeah, and I'll echo exactly what Mike said with a quick just addendum on that and on the complexity of what we're thinking about and talking about when we're talking about predation. And I'll use an example that's occurring right now. I mean, as we speak, I've got a couple of studies going on in Louisiana, one in the West Central area and one in the Southeast. We've lost a half a dozen nests to predation in one region. We haven't had a nest predated yet in the other. There is absolutely, and I was talking to Mike earlier, it's totally unexpected. There's absolutely no reason that I can identify that turkeys that effectively started laying and incubating at the exact same time in maybe a little bit different vegetated communities, but not that different. We're talking about, you know, pine forest, southern pine forest. All of a sudden, you have one area where there's no predation and one where there's, you know, we've lost half the nest already.
Yep.
And that goes back to Mike's point of studying turkeys and being turkey scientists. You know, and it's not just about studying turkeys. It's about, okay, what do we know about how the predator species interact with the birds, and the predator species ecology has to come into play as well. So, you know, when we talk about how far, how much there is to go, there's a lot left to go.
Yeah.
Very good, gentlemen. I tell you what, I mean, I could still have a few more drinks. Might have to get a snack in hand, and we could continue this conversation. I know I've had a bunch of them over campfires and on tailgates of trucks in the turkey woods with other hunters. I mean, it's a popular topic, and I agree with you guys. I mean, we have a lot of them out there. I just want to thank you two for being on this week. I appreciate everyone that's stepped in and watched today. Thanks for the great questions. I also want to thank a couple of guys behind the scenes today helping us navigate this journey for this first session of our spring seclusion, Mr. Mark Hatfield, and I want to thank Mr. Pete Muller. These two cats have been working through the questions, making sure everything's working smoothly today, and we're going to continue working that in the upcoming weeks. We have five more weeks to go through some cool topics, and what I'm asking from you people out there, I'm asking for y'all to put comments in on what you want to hear about, whether it's habitat, fire ants. I think we're done with predators, but whatever it may be, prescribed fire, hunting seasons, regulations, you name it, I want to hear from you. So what I'm asking anyone out there, throw some comments at us. Let's see if we can figure out what's the most popular comments, and what we'll do, we'll compile those, and we'll develop new topics for the next 5 weeks. You'll hear more from us in the upcoming days on what that's going to be. We're going to tune in at the same time because no doubt I'm going to have hopefully a full drink next time for cocktails and conservation as we continue with the spring seclusion. We're going to do this again next Wednesday, 5 p.m. Eastern. We're going to go for at least an hour, but I have a feeling we're going to go longer than that because we are having good conversation, enjoying the cocktails, and learn a little bit on the fun side of things today. So thanks again. Hope we all have a good evening and stay safe out there. See y'all.
It's interesting to sit here and still be live.